know who God says I am, where he says I am, what he says.
Lord, we give you thanks and praise for this amazing day that you have blessed us with. We pray that your joy will fill our hearts. We pray that it shall be the reason why we dance. In Jesus' name I pray. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let me see your hands up here, everyone. Mikono juu tuende. Hands in the air, everyone. Okay, 1, 2, 3, break it down.
Hey! Jump, 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 jump.
Let me see you jump. Come on, come on, come on, come on.
Peperusha.
Wave them,
Peperusha.
Form of worship is when you praise God anyway, regardless of what you will be enjoying, regardless of what you would be missing, regardless of what you will be desiring, regardless of what you'll be having, regardless of what you would not be having. When you choose to praise God deliberately, intentionally, without looking at your circumstances, then that worship becomes accurate. And I think that's really where I would want to invite us this morning as we follow the worship team, as they lead us in making a deliberate choice to follow God. Just open your mouth and verbalize this words that we have been singing, that Lord, I choose to follow you this day anyway. I choose to believe in you anyway. I choose to trust upon you anyway. I choose to declare you my God whichever way. I choose to make you God in this circumstance. I choose to make you the God of the mountain. I choose to make you the God of the hill. I choose to make you the God of the valley. I choose to make the God of pleasure. I choose to make you the God of pain. I choose to make you God when I'm celebrating. I choose to make you God when I'm crying. I choose to make you God in all my circumstances. For this reason, Lord, this morning we bless you. We bless you because you are God. You're God when we have joy. You're God when we're in sadness. You're God when we have plenty. You're God when we have few. You're God in all circumstances in our lives. And this morning, Lord, we raise our hands towards you and declare you God regardless of the joy we have, regardless of the sadness we have, regardless of what we are missing this morning. Father, we declare that you are God in this space. You are the God of all circumstances. You are God in joy. You are God in pain. You are God in sadness. You are God in all things. And we choose to bless your holy name. Come on, if you believe those words, just keep going and shout and celebrate the Lord.
I'm very grateful to co-host with Hula Hula. Some of us have sleepless night, hoping that something will happen tomorrow. So, you know, praying for something so hard.
You know what, Stone?
Yes.
For me, actually, I want to engage each one of us with a neighbor next to you. I don't know how you feel when you're making a call and somebody's not picking that call, and you're telling yourself, God, please pick that call. Please just share the person next to you and ask them, or tell them about this instance you had where somebody was just not picking that urgent call. You're in this situation. Come on, guys, let's just share your story, and we'll get probably sample, maybe one person. Yeah?
Yes. Get to share with somebody.
That feeling you feel.
All right, we're gonna sample one. Who amongst us feels like, you know, yangu ilikuwa ile moto moto, you know, you guys can't beat mine. Ah, we have somebody on this end. Let's clap for her. She's a fearless influencer.
It's a bit funny you're calling someone, probably because you're going for an interview and they're one of your referees. But you know they are, but probably them, they don't know. So you want to tell them, you're one of my referees, and I'm going for an interview. Please, if you're called, I'm the one.
All right, let's give it up for her.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes.
She's just reminded me of some years back. Eh?
Yes.
This situation almost applied to me.
Uh-huh.
Because what happened is, I had this interview I was going for, and I had these referees. But now,
yes,
I was trying to get to call one referee to tell them the job vacancy position I'm being called for. Mm-hmm. But I couldn't get them. And guess what? The employer got to them before I did, and the referee is talking about something totally different
from
what, you know. Oh my goodness. So I feel you, I do. Thank you so much.
Let's give it up for Hula Hula. They're in the same situation with my friend on the other end. It's that, as we said, the series for this month is Unanswered. And some of us have been in those hard situations. Maybe you applied for a job, you don't know the response. Sindo. Some of us have actually been working, and the probation period was 6 months. You're still there. It's like the 9th month, and you don't know whether you're confirmed or not. You're in that uncertainty mode. Some of us applied to go to school,
and you don't know whether to pick up the phone and call them, ask them, did my application go through? They didn't call you back. So I'd like us to take a look at this short clip, even as we welcome Pastor Chogo on stage.
Good morning, church. Is it still morning? Oh, okay, morning is, you know, until we eat lunch, it's still morning. This is a special day, and we thank God because of what He is doing in our midst, and for all of you that have come into God's house this morning. I bring you greetings from our, should I say, mother church or grandmother church, Nairobi Chapel. We were there with my family last week. You even notice my English is a bit updated. We were out there and we were doing the our thing there, preaching, and God blessed us. We had an amazing time. A couple of people came to know Jesus, and I'm not sure they sent me with greetings, but I mean, just receive greetings. Hashtag unanswered is our hashtag. Interact with us on Twitter as we do the sermon today. I'll invite us to do so. We're going to invite you, hashtag unanswered. And our Twitter handle is at Mavuno Mashariki, at Mavuno Mashariki, hashtag unanswered. And so let's begin tweeting so that our friends can hear God's word, can read God's word wherever they are, especially those who've not been able to come to church. Welcome. Happy New Month. For those of us who are joining us for the first time, you're welcome. I also want to give a shout out to the Mavuno 58 worship team. Aren't they amazing? Yeah. My goodness. What good stuff. I tell you, I'm going to be spending a bit of time preaching in Mavuno 58. If you probably have to change my salary for me to. But these guys are amazing. We want to talk about unanswered when God seems unavailable. We're beginning a new sermon series this month, and I'll tell you more about it as we continue with this series. But I don't know, and I guess as you were having conversations with Stone and the others who are leading us through the service, they asked a question: if you've ever been in a situation where you needed somebody and you called them, and it, this phone went like mteja apatikani, or the mobile subscriber cannot be reached. And it's a bad feeling. And I have had such situations. I've had situations where somebody owes me money and they told me, call me at the end of the month, and I'm trying to call them at first. It seems like it's gone through. When I try next, it is, busy. The next time I try, it's the mobile subscriber does not want to be reached. It almost feels like that sometimes. I don't know, and most of us, probably some of us, have been in such situations. We are starting out on a new series, and we are saying, sometimes dealing with God feels like calling that person that you really need, and heaven sends a message back to you the God you're trying to reach cannot be reached. Unanswered when God seems unavailable. In this series, we're going to wrestle with the question of what happens in those moments when God is seemingly unreachable. Those moments in my life when I've prayed and fasted and, you know, done everything that the good book says I should do to get the attention of God, and it seems like God is not about to change my situation. Times when I've expected God to come through to change my situation, and after prayer and fasting, nothing seems to be changing. The situation remains the same or becomes worse. And you know, maybe God is answering other prayers that I'm making. Maybe God is answering other prayers that I'm making for other people. But it seems like there's this one situation that He is not responding to, and I'm crying to Him about, and nothing seems to change. When God seems unavailable. And it could range, you know, from all sorts of personal situations that we are wrestling with and we are struggling with. You prayed over and over again, and you reached the point where you're not sure if God is listening, or if God, if there is any God out there, and you're probably crying, is God out there? Does God really care? And sometimes it's not just personal situation. It is situations that are happening in the country. And some of you probably are wrestling with the fact that there's unabated corruption going on in the country. There's unabated crime going on in the country, and you've lost a friend or two. And you're wondering, you know, is God concerned? Does God have any power left to sort out some of these things? Does God know that Christians are being beheaded somewhere in Syria or in Iraq? And you know, this can cause us to come to the place where we're no longer optimistic about prayer and about the prospects of God responding to our prayers. And some of these situations may not be happening to you. It may be happening to somebody you know, and you're so sure this person loves God and they're tight with God. They go to church. They have a testimony. They believe in God. But things, it seems like life is just throwing the worst at them. Do I have some witness here? And this situation is compounded and made even worse. When you know some people, and even God knows, those people are bad. They are evil. I mean, you know, they cheat on taxes, they cheat on their wives or husbands, they drive badly, they are bad neighbors, but it seems like everything is working out for them. I mean, they have just bought 2 new cars, and their kids are moving to the other school. The one that the bus comes and picks people from their gates. And you're like, God, do you have a warped sense of justice? And as you try to reach out to God, it seems like God has engaged in a conspiracy of silence and is conspicuously silent. And the situation is not made better by people around you who always have testimonies. Oh no, you know, I woke up in the morning and I trusted God for sausages, and M-Pesa came in and I went and bought sausages. I mean, it seems like God is just doing anything and everything for them. Do you have friends like that? And there's nothing happening in your life, and you're confused about God's sense of response. See, the question is, what do we do with the feelings that are evoked by this kind of situations? What do we do? What do we do with those feelings? In those moments when God seems is distant and he doesn't want to engage, what do we do? When there's that feeling that even if there's a God out there, it seems like he doesn't want to engage, what do we do? And in those moments, we are tempted to think, perhaps, maybe, God doesn't care. Or maybe God has lost power. And in those moments, our faith begins to dwindle. Our confidence begins to dwindle. And there goes our hope begins to dwindle. Today, we want to examine the life of a character in the Bible to help us wrestle with this question of a God who is seemingly silent in the face of our circumstance. And we want to consider a character by the name of John. Now, Jesus calls John the greatest man that lived in that time when Jesus was on earth. He calls him the greatest among those who have been born of women. He says, of all the men born of women, John is the greatest. He was a great guy. And I tell you, for Jesus to say you're a great guy, you're a great guy. Hello? How many of you know when Jesus says yes, nobody can say no? When Jesus says you are the bomb, you're the blast. All right? And so imagine all the talented people in his time. Jesus says, this one is the greatest among them. We know him as John the Baptist. And let's read one or two things about John the Baptist. And we're going to read from the book of Matthew or Matthew. Matthew if you went to DEB, primary school. But Matthew chapter 11 from verse 1 to 6. I will invite us to read that for a moment. This is what the Bible says. Matthew 11, 1 to 6. It says, now it came to pass when Jesus finished commanding his disciples, he departed from there to teach and preach in their cities. And when John had heard in prison what the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said to him, are you the coming one, or do we look for another? Jesus answered and said to them, go and tell John the things which you hear and see. The blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he who is not offended because of me. May God bless the reading of his word. Very interesting piece of scripture. But let me give us a little background to this scripture. Now, in those days when John was operating as the prophet of God, as the preacher of righteousness, there was a king in the land of Israel by the name of Herod Antipas. Herod Antipas. You need to follow me carefully on this. Herod Antipas. And Herod Antipas, when he became king, decided to get married. He moved into the palace with a new queen. And the name of the new queen was Herodias. Somebody say Herodias. Now, this is about to get a little complicated. Because Herodias, for her to become the queen, to get married to Herod Antipas, had to divorce. I'm trying to use better words, to divorce from her former husband, who was called Herod Philip. Now, there is Herod Antipas, there is Herodias in the middle there, and then there is Herod Philip. How did Herodias divorce from Herod Philip? It's as simple as this. Herod Antipas, who was the brother to Herod Philip, went to visit Herod Philip and realized that he has a more beautiful wife than he could have imagined he'll ever get. And so he began to vibe Herodias, who was the wife to his brother. Are we still together? Long and short of it, Herod Antipas the king snatched a wife from his own brother. Nivindio nindrama. Now let me tell you, that was unacceptable among the Jews. It was unacceptable It can't happen. But Herod did it. Now, everybody began talking about it. Everybody began talking. Now, something about John the Baptist. John the Baptist was this fiery preacher of righteousness. I mean, John the Baptist had like a following of 5,000 plus on Twitter. John the Baptist was happening. And John the Baptist, people loved him. And why did they love John the Baptist? Because he never shied away from addressing social issues. He would take on anyone and everyone. He was not afraid of anybody. And John the Baptist in our time and day here in Kenya would be like a combination of Robert Alai, you know, and Boniface Mwangi and Pastor Chogo put together. You know, I mean, he would take on issues. And people would, you know, hashtag him on issues. And so John the Baptist, when he was on internet, he came across Gafler. And Gafler, he saw, you know, Herodias as, you know, eloped with his brother's wife. Hey! And so John the Baptist decided he must speak about it. And so one of these days, Herodias is driving down, no, he's riding down, she's riding down rather, she's walking down, you know, John the Baptist loved to preach besides River Jordan. And so Herodias, the queen, is, you know, walking down River Road next to the river. Riverside, no, not Riverside, River Road, let's stick with River Road. And because, you know, you can't go and preach at Riverside, you know, you can't do that. But River Road. And so John the Baptist is preaching there. He's having his little gathering and he's preaching. And he's mentioning something about Herodias. And Herodias gets to hear that she's being mentioned by some roadside, Riverside, River Road preacher. And the preacher is condemning what they have done. And at that moment, Herodias develops a distaste for John. And when she goes back home, she tells her husband, the king, you must take care of this little preacher at River Road. I want him to disappear. Make him disappear. You have the power to make people disappear. Make him disappear. Otherwise, you will need to budget for several months sleeping on the couch. Disappear. But you see, now there's a little dilemma, because Herod Antipas needs to consolidate his, he has begun on a bad note, and so he needs to consolidate his leadership over this, and so he cannot afford beheading or killing John the Baptist, because John the Baptist is loved by the people. He can't afford an insurrection in his early years of being king, and so he is torn between. So Herod Antipas goes for middle ground, goes for a compromise. Arrests John the Baptist and throws him in prison. And so the good preacher is in prison. Let's pick it up from there, because Matthew 11 picks it up from there. You can imagine how John the Baptist felt about this, because John the Baptist had done his job pretty well. He had laid the ground for the Messiah. He had done his work. He had prepared the way. He had been good at doing that. And after he has been faithful in all that he has done, the best that could happen to him after he has ushered Jesus on the stage is for him to end up in prison. That must have been a struggle for John the Baptist. And I don't know how many of us feel that you have done everything right. You've done the prayers. You've done the fasting. You've given the tithes. And you've been faithful. And it seems like the situations are not changing in your life. And sometimes as a church, we shy away from talking about that. We want to spend time talking about the people who have testimonies. But we don't take time to talk about you and I, who have been there, done that, bought the t-shirt, signed up, and things have not changed. As he rotted away in prison day after day, he struggled. But then there are guys who used to come and visit John the Baptist. Probably we could have some of the doors opened just for ventilation purposes. Probably the guys who used to come and visit John the Baptist in prison, and so some of his disciples who had joined Jesus because he had deferred them to Jesus, and so one of these days they come to visit him, and he's like, guys, how is Jesus doing? Now let me say something about Jesus and John the Baptist. Do you know they were cousins? They were cousins. And so he says, you know, how is cousin doing? They're like, wow, it's happening. And does he ever mention me? Rarely. Then he's like, come on, guys. I want you to go and give him a certain message. I want to send you with a message to my cousin. He says, what's the message? Then John the Baptist tells them, go and ask him. Is he really the person I was talking about? Is he really the Messiah? Because, you know, John the Baptist was expecting that this man that he had set up would have returned the favor when he heard he was in prison. But this is now the 10th month, and Jesus has never visited John the Baptist. Are you really the Messiah? Do you really care for me? If you're healing the sick and delivering people out there, can't you just spare one small miracle for me? To make matters worse, the guys who used to come and visit John would tell John, you know what? He is doing miracles even for strangers. Strangers? And his cousin is in prison? And so they went, they struggled, you know, they told him, you know what, you're the one who told us he's the Messiah. How can you ask us to go and ask him if he's the Messiah? You are the one. What is this double speech? But then they got their act together and they went and looked for Jesus. And they sheepishly, Messiah, bear with your cousin. I think the prison is doing some things on him. I think it's the food in prison that's missing. But he's asking, please, it's not us. We've been sent. Don't shoot the messenger. He's asking, are you the one? Have you ever been asked a silly question? All right, people who meet with you walking towards, you know, the stage, you're going to grab a mat, they ask you, unaenda job? No, I'm my feet are just moving and I don't know why. And so Jesus decides to respond to them. And there's something amazing about Jesus' response, because it helps us to begin to answer questions about when God doesn't look like he is concerned or when God is silent. He says, go back to John the Baptist and tell him several things. He says, tell him what you have seen and what you have heard. The things that are happening, the miracles that are happening, go and tell him about those things. And you know, I wondered, why would Jesus send the disciples with a message like that in response to the query that John had raised? It's because I feel like many of us, sometimes when we are in that prison, in that situation that seems like it's not changing and God is not responding, sometimes we reduce God, our perspective of God, to the size of our circumstance. And that was John the Baptist's mistake. Jesus says, go and tell him that his world, the world is not revolving around that prison cell, because sometimes we reduce our view of God to our circumstance. It's like somehow God becomes different because our circumstances are different. Our lives and our worldviews shrink to the size of the prison we are in sometimes. And we are unable to see beyond the problem. We are unable to see beyond the prison. That's why we struggle when God seems inattentive to us. When God seems like he's not responding to us. Because when we are in difficult times, because we reduce him to the size of our prison and our circumstances. And in that place where we feel stuck in the rut, our faith begins to falter. Our trust in God begins to falter. Like John the Baptist, he asked, is he really the one? He began to doubt. And so here is John the Baptist with all that he had seen and all that he had heard, with all that he knows, and suddenly his world is no bigger than his prison cell. Ask your neighbor, have you reduced God? Ask your neighbor, have you reduced God to the size of your circumstance? And this is what makes the response of Jesus remarkable. Jesus doesn't say, yes, of course, I'm the Messiah. Jesus doesn't say, yeah, I'm going to come and rescue you. No. Jesus tells them to go and tell John the Baptist to do a few things. Number one, go and tell John the Baptist to lift up his eyes above and beyond his circumstance and to look beyond his prison cell and to see the activity of God. And number one, ask him to consider what God has already done. Ask him to look back at what God has already done. And I think it would have helped the apostle, John the Baptist, it would have helped him if he looked back at some of the things that God had done. In fact, it would have helped John the Baptist to look back and recognize that he had already served God's purpose. And God had worked with him. But his prison cell was clouding him. There's another man in the Bible called the Apostle Paul who was in the same predicament as John the Baptist because he was also in prison. And we find him in 2 Timothy chapter 4 from verse 6 to 8. He's also in prison and he's wondering, why isn't God rescuing me from prison? In fact, a few years earlier, God had rescued the Apostle Peter miraculously from prison. You remember the story in Acts chapter 12 where Peter walked miraculously out of prison? I mean, the gates were opening automatically for him, and probably Apostle Paul was hoping that the same miracle can be repeated, but he was still rotting away in prison until he made some resolve. He decided to look back at what God had already done in his life and the things that they had already accomplished with God, and listen to what the Apostle Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 4. He says, for I am already being poured out like a drink offering. The time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on my day. Not only to me, but all those who have longed for his appearing. It says, look back. Sometimes in the middle of situations that seems like God is not giving us the response we want, we forget the things that God has already done. I feel God is asking us today to look back. And I feel that the most critical thing God is asking us in this situation where we're beginning to lose faith is, will you trust me? Will you trust me? Or will you begin to create a God who fits into your plans, who responds to you the way you want? And so Jesus told John, raise your eyes beyond your prison and begin to see a God who may not necessarily respond the way you want, but he's still a God at work. I want to suggest to you that your circumstances and your situations do not in any way determine who God is, God is still God, despite and in spite of your circumstances. He is still on the throne. And that's what God was telling John in prison. Look back. Look back at the answered prayers. When he saved your marriage, when he gave you a child, when you were troubled, when you had a troubled teenager, he rescued you, your past experiences. Now will you begin to start questioning God's credibility because of this one situation you are stuck in? God is still God, irrespective of our circumstances. I thought I should hear an amen there. And sometimes God doesn't express himself to us the way we expect him to. Number two, I suspect Jesus was telling John the Baptist that don't just look back, look outside and reflect on the activities that God is doing around about you. Yeah, those testimonies by your friends may hurt you, may make you feel like God is unfair, but you need to consider those testimonies. You need to consider what God is doing in the lives of other people. When you are entrapped in your circumstances, you need sometimes to raise your eyes and look beyond and catch a glimpse of the activity of God outside your little world. You need to understand that your situation, your circumstances is only but a portion of God's greater scheme of things. And that God's activity does not revolve around your little circumstance, John. And I'm talking to somebody here. And so Jesus was telling John, you need to trust me. Even when the greater scheme of things seems to obscure your circumstance. God tell John, I'm at work. The grand plan is still in place. In as much as it doesn't future his circumstance. And I must say something as I try to land this conversation. What John and many of us forget in the midst of circumstances here on earth in our human experience is that the story of our engagement with God does not end with circumstances here on earth. It goes beyond the grave. And that sometimes our experience here on earth is just but a dot compared to God's greater scheme of plans for you. Because God's plan for you is not limited to your human experience. There is an eternity. In fact, our life here on earth compared to eternity is just but a dot. And sometimes God may not do things the way you want him to do in your human experience here. But I tell you what, all things work together for good to them that love God in the eternal scheme of things. In fact, the Apostle Paul says that these temporal afflictions will give way to an eternal glory. Turn to your neighbor and tell him there is a bigger picture. And sometimes the big picture is eternity. And I tell you what, for some of us, we may never resolve God's agenda for our lives here on earth. We may need to step into eternity. And that's not all that Jesus tells John. Because the story of John doesn't end well. It doesn't end with God miraculously coming to rescue John. In fact, the story goes that Herodias and Herod one day had a birthday party and they got drunk. And in his drunken stupor, the king asked for his stepdaughter to dance because Herodias came with a daughter from the previous marriage. And she danced. She danced. She did, you know, all the stuff. I don't know what kind of dance she was doing, but she danced. I tell you, she danced until the king was like, what? What a dance. Wow. And so in his drunkenness, he says, what would you want me to give you, even if it's half the kingdom? And so the teenager, I would have expected the teenager to ask for an iPhone 5 or an iPod. But the teenager does what many teenagers don't do. He says, let me go and ask mommy. I wish my teenagers would behave like that. Let me go and ask mommy. And so the teenager goes to the mother, and she comes back with the most horrific of answers. The head of John the Baptist on a plate. And that's how the life of John the Baptist ends here on earth. But that's not how the story of John the Baptist ends, because we are still talking about him today. In eternity, he still lives on, because that circumstance was not the end of the story. I want you to know something that comes out very clearly from the story of John the Baptist, that God is sovereign. God is sovereign. See, the sovereignty of God dictates that he is not subject to the wishes of any person. He is not like an ATM machine that you can press any time and it gives you money. Sometimes even ATMs have a mind of their own. You need to understand that God has a mind of his own. And the sovereignty of God is exciting when he's overruling your boss on your behalf, when he's overruling other circumstances on your behalf, and he's overruling your enemies on your behalf. But you need to understand, just as much as the sovereignty of God dictates he can overrule on your behalf, the sovereignty of God dictates he can overrule you because of other greater things. And so in this instance, God overrules John and says, I will not bring you out of prison, because of a greater scheme and a plan. There's a little problem with that, because Pastor Chogo and many other pastors, we've been teaching that God will answer all your prayers. Oh, just pray, push, pray until something happens. But good people have come back humbly, having been humbled by God, to submit to you that sometimes he will not answer, because he is God. See, if God automatically answered every prayer, then we will reduce God to a formula. And God is not a formula. We reduce him to a formula, and that is witchcraft. Witchcraft is when where you're guaranteed, if you mix this, if you bring a black cow and a yellow monkey and a pink chicken, then that person will be paralyzed. Now, God is not witchcraft. God is sovereign. He has a mind of his own. And we must come to the place where we choose to trust him regardless of how he responds. And so my question to us today as I conclude is, will you trust God? Or will you choose to waver and take your faith to look for another God who does things the way you want him to do? Will you trust God when he doesn't answer the way you want him to answer? Will you trust God? And this is what God, Jesus tells John. I may not get you out of prison, but do not lose faith in me. Because blessed are you when you're not offended by me. Blessed are you when you choose to trust God when things are not working. Blessed are you when you choose to trust God when that child is not getting better. Blessed are you when you choose to trust God when that job opportunity still doesn't look like it's coming. Blessed are you when you choose to trust God even when you've been sacked and fired. Blessed are you when you choose to trust God even in your business. That is the highest level of faith, and God salutes you. He says you're blessed. Now, I don't know what blessed means there, but when God says you're blessed, that's the best thing that can be said of you. You're blessed. So will you trust God even when it doesn't make sense? Unanswered, when God is silent, will you still trust him? I want us to listen to a little song and then we can pray. I don't know where you are at. I don't know what situation you're in. But I feel God is saying, look here. Look back at what he has already done, at God's activity, and reflect on it. Look outside your prison and appreciate what he's doing, and don't lose your faith. And then look up and appreciate the sovereignty of God and allow God to be God. Because that's where you'll find blessedness. That's where you'll find purpose. See, friends, the worst thing that could have happened to John the Baptist is for him to live 100 years outside of God's purpose. But the best thing that ever happened to John the Baptist is that he died at 30 something, but in the purpose of God. It's better to die in the will of God than to live for a long time outside his will. Will you trust him? Just listen to this, then we can pray.
What if I tell you to let go of the very thing that you think you have to hold? Will you trust me? Yes. I'll trust you, Lord. What if it costs my life? Yes. I'll trust you, Lord. What if I lose the very thing I love so dear? Yes. Somebody say, yes, I'll trust you, Lord. Somebody say, yes. Come on, put your hand up and say, yes, I'll trust you, Lord. I'll trust you. I'll trust you. I'll trust you. I can hear Jesus singing. He says this.
Trust him, even when you don't feel him near. Father God, this is difficult for us. Because I wish that today we would leave this place with an assurance that you will do everything we want you to do, oh God. But you're telling us, and you're inviting us to a higher level of worship, where we will trust you even when you will not do that which we wish you will do. Even when you seem like you're silent. Help us, Lord, because this is difficult for us. For many of us, and I ask you, oh God, to have mercy on us, because as your servant, I have stood here before these people and I've told them many times that you will answer their prayers. But today you're telling us sometimes things may not go the way we wish, and that we must be willing to submit ourselves, and that's where true worship comes in. That's where true discipleship comes in, when we can still follow you and trust you. And we can say like Jesus, not my will, but your will be done, even when it's painful. Help us, oh God, to grow to that level of faith. That level of faith that you commended the saints of God in the book of Hebrews chapter 11. And your word says that some of them died in faith, having not received their promise, but they were strong in faith. And your word commends them as giants of faith. May you help us in this church to become giants of faith, who will believe you not because of our circumstances, not because you are providing, but because you are God, who will worship you because of who you are and not because of what you can do, who will love you not because you are doing us good, but because you are God. Probably there are some of us who are saying, Pastor, I appreciate what you have preached to us today, but I'm struggling. I am at that place where John the Baptist was, and I don't feel that God is responding to me, and I'm struggling with it. I'm stuck in a situation. I need encouragement. I'm asking the questions that John the Baptist asked. And you need prayer, you need encouragement, you need strength. I want to pray for God's grace to strengthen you. I'll ask you, wherever you are, just to raise up your hand. You're saying, I'm that person. I'm that person. God bless you. I'm that person. Bless you. Father God, you can see these hands that are being lifted. A few of us who are saying they're in situations that don't make sense, and they're struggling to hang on to their faith in you. Father, my hope is that you can turn these situations around. Lord, my hope is that you can intervene in this. And I know you can. I know you have the power. But I pray that, oh God, for these dear ones, as they wait on you, as they are in the depth of their circumstance, as they feel stuck in that rut, I pray, may you strengthen them. May you strengthen them. I have asked them to hang on there. I have asked them to still trust you, but sometimes faith is not easy. I pray, may you strengthen their hearts. May they find faith to hold on. Jesus, you prayed for Peter, and you told Peter, your faith will be tested. The devil has asked permission to test your faith, but I've prayed for you. Father, I pray that you will help these dear ones to find strength to believe you in spite and despite. And so may your grace be sufficient for us, O God, in the midst of our circumstance. Help us, O God, in Jesus' name. While our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, I want to pray for one more category of people. You're saying, I've come to the house of God, and I don't want to live the rest of my life outside of God's purpose. I want to be found at the center of God's purpose for my life. And the first step in moving towards God's purpose for your life is to invite Him to be Lord and Savior over your life. You're saying, I want to receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior today. I don't want to continue living outside His will and His purpose. Just raise up your hand wherever you are, and I will pray for you. You're saying, I want Jesus to come into my life. Is there such a person in our midst? Any one of us who is saying, I need Jesus to come into my life, I want to pray for you wherever you are. Just raise up your hand and I'll pray for you. Is there such a person? Is there such a person? Is there such a person? Saying, I want to give my life to Jesus. I want to give my life to Jesus. There being none, we thank God. Heavenly Father, we bless you. Ah, Lord, I pray that you will dismiss us. With the encouragement that you are still God in spite and despite our circumstances. And that our circumstances do not reduce you. Our circumstances do not change you. You remain God. And for that we give you praise and we give you glory. If you believe he remains to be God regardless of your circumstance, I dare you to give him a clap and to worship him. We will trust him in spite and despite. Allow me to bless us. First time visitors, make sure you go to the visitor's tent. Stretch your hands towards me. I declare you blessed. Not because of what you're going through, not because of what you have or what you don't have, not because of what you will become or never become, but I declare you blessed because God himself looks at you and declares you blessed. God says you are better than your circumstance, that you should not reduce yourself to the level of your struggles. Because God thinks highly of you beyond your struggles. I declare you blessed because God says you're blessed. And so walk into this week blessed. Eat your food blessed. Sleep blessed. Rise up blessed. I declare you blessed in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And the church says, amen. God bless you. Come with a friend next week. Please make sure you pick a flyer. Make sure you pick a flyer or two. Invite a friend. This is important conversations. Pick a flyer or two. Invite a friend. Amen. I am under the rock.